I mean, I'll hold this up. This is the guts of this is the guts of the.
That's the motherboard that used to work. And welcome back to another Linux Gamecast Weekly Show to cover the latest Linux gaming news, reviews, how-tos, and most importantly, whatever the hell else we come up with this week. It's kind of short news segment, to be honest with you guys.
Yeah, not a lot happens.
No, man. I mean, there's definitely the big story we're going to be talking about. That's the NVIDIA thing. And like, we can speculate and have fun. Me and Pedro even hung out and had sexy time over Jensen's hidden video cards. I thought about it. I couldn't find a place to hide them. I was going to try to hide some video cards in the background.
what you need to do is have like a little Jensen pop up in post, or like a leather jacket that just swoops in randomly.
Comes in here and attacks me, and I have to fight it off with a katana.
Yeah, no,
that was completely missed opportunity because I have a leather jacket and I was not wearing it.
Oh, man.
Go get it! Run, no. Run, bitch!
Nay. Oh, Chatroom Dynamic, join us live. You're helping us form that special bit known as Cocaine Voltron. Before we get going, we do like to see what's going on in each other's life organs, man. I'm putting on my victory lap shoes because I might get to take one, you guys, because there's been a long, long standing bug with OBS and Jack. We used Jack in the studio to network all this nonsense, and well, it was kind of RNG because you could record, you would see the audio and the VU meters. You just go check your recording later. No audio. I made a bug report, and I know four other people have made this bug report over the last 2 years. Always, like, closed, won't fix, something's wrong in your end, OBS, we're perfect. Which was really more like, we don't know what's going on, but we're going to hide it behind, it's a buffer overflow error. Finally. Thank you, Flying Spaghetti Monster. They closed the bug report on the right guy. Because it's like, you know what? No. I'm going to start looking into it. Which, just a cursory glance, he's like, man, this thing's not even set up for real-time permission. So, of course, it's going to barf everywhere. So, yeah, I'm lacing up my victory lap shoes. Hopefully, that just gets fixed. I've never been a fan of it, mainly because it fails silently. But that's pretty much it. Also, for you beautiful party patrons, there's a early look. If you're curious about how this nonsense is stuck together, there's the mid-2020 studio update. I know Steven even popped in. He's like, hey, man, I'm doing the teaching thing. This is helpful. So give that a watch if you want. Jordan, I heard you have a new precious.
It's mine.
Also, I need a 2950X because apparently 12 cores is mainstream these days. I don't feel special anymore.
Right? Yeah. So like, I don't know. I'm like, it much like salmon when it's time to swim upstream. It's that time of the decade. Every 5 years or so where my brain goes, you know what, it's time to pull the trigger on a new box. So I parted it out. I got the 3900X. Mm. I got the MSI Mag BXX.
Hold the tower up while everything's plugged in. It's running.
I mean, I'll hold this up. This is the guts of... This is the guts of the...
That's the motherboard that used to work.
Yeah, it's
got
fine.
Dinged into a microphone.
The CPU is the one that's a little fragile, right? Like,
very thin substrate.
Very, very thin substrate. Yeah, so I'm on the 3900X now. Life is good. I like my little XFCE CPU monitor thing just freaking out in the corner because it's like, oh my god, you have 24 CPUs. I'm gonna use up like half the bar now.
You'll cut that off.
No,
you will, trust me.
I think I'll keep it.
It gets old.
Hey man, I haven't changed my Discord avatar in forever. I can live with.
That's because you make. Come on, man. You co-opt laziness as your thing, and you stick with it.
Absolutely. See? And I set this up forever ago, and I'm lazy, so I'm not going to remove it. Checkmate, atheists.
Good on Linux, man. Popping that NVMe drive in. Boop, done.
Oh yeah, that was the thing. I'm like, I had to reseat it, but we talked about the pre-super shows, but yeah, like, plugged it in, it's like, yeah, this is a completely different motherboard, processor, and RAM. Linux is like, oh, whatever. X starts up fine. Don't need to reinstall anything.
Hold my microcode.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. It's like, wait, that microcode doesn't matter. Never mind.
Whatever.
whatever. I got other microcode. It's fine.
It's come a long way, man, because I remember dude, I know it's forever ago, but that used to not be the case. That was like, nuke and pave.
Yeah. Admittedly, if you have any kind of specific drivers installed for specific hardware, you should probably do that, yeah.
Mr. Alert, I'm curious. In 2020 with a new motherboard, it's always UEFI.
Yeah. This one has like hybrid on by default. I don't remember what the boot setup for anyways. The one boo-boo thing, and this seems to be a constant with MSI motherboards I buy, the onboard like 6 gigabit NIC or whatever, no worky under Linux. It doesn't get picked up. I haven't done any research into it because I have a million of these USB 3 gigabit NICs, mm-hmm. and I just plugged one into the back, and then I got on with my life.
Yeah, the one on my Threadripper board and the one on my V350, they just work.
Lucky
yeah,
you.
Yeah, on my X570, it also works.
It's probably a Fedora thing.
Maybe. This is like the MSI Turbo fuck you NPU, Nick. So, it like I said, it happened on the last MSI board.
Is it Broadcom? Because that probably explained it.
Yeah, mine's Intel.
I would be...
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I don't have like the Turbo Fly. They put the one that works on the
Yeah, yeah, boards. Yeah. If you got Intel networking, shit, yeah, motherfucker, that all works. But like, whatever, like... I don't get 6 gigabits on my gigabit home network.
Oh, man. I feels for you, baby. Pedro, anything new in the land of Britannia?
Nori came up to me. It's like, we should get a new TV. It's like, all right, I'll call Nathan. So I told Nathan, it's like, yo, you want to come pick up your TV? It's like, actually, yeah, I do. Like, cool. Come pick it up then. So, yeah, currently I have no TV, and I took this time to take the Steam Box apart in all its wonderful glory, because I'm going to put a fan in this hole.
Sexy.
Is that yes. only because it has an uneven number amount of fans in it currently?
No, it's actually got an even amount of fans in it currently, I'm going to uneven
it. You want an extra one?
Yeah.
No, it has to be a bit thinner because there's not enough clearance between, like, you know, the metal cage and the bottom of the
listen,
Xbox
man,
360.
Listen.
Is there enough room in Nicolas Cage?
We can make this work.
No. It's a 92 mil fan will fit in that hole because I measured it. So, yeah, it's just a matter of ordering one, but those knock to a... 1.5 centimeter thick 92 mil fans. They're like 15 pounds for just a fan.
You know what? Compared to the horse, that's a reasonable price.
Horse is way too expensive for what you get with it. These days, like, it's all decomposed. It's just like a
no RGB.
It just has G. It's the mold that's growing on it. It's the Steam
Linux
update.
EA Play has fuck all to do with Linux, but we need to talk about it because it's currently available on Steam, ladies and gentlemen. That's right, top-tier titles for $4.99. Give us your money because this is a legitimate greed tornado. EA went from, you know, hey, Steam's a cool place for making money. Hey, I bet we could do our own store, make some more money. Like, fuck, I bet we can still make more money if we come back to Steam in some way, shape, form, or fuck. Here we are. You know what? You know what? I'm just going to say this. This is the main reason I threw this in, because for me, my only thought is like, Valve, you need to get on this, kids, because this is what Valve should offer 100%. They should have an entire library for developers that want to jump in. They're like, yo, if you want in, you can get on the Valve thing. Here's a subscription. This is nothing I haven't said before. And why do we need this? Because just like Netflix was great. Netflix was fucking wonderful because all the studios in DC and all the other fuckers, then they saw how much money. Then all the studios wanted a fucking taste of it. So now we're going to have all the fucking publishers like, hey, Valve, can we do a thing for our 6 games and our 6? Then you're going to end up with 16 damn subscriptions.
Mm-hmm. And that's the thing, because EA, like them or not, because they are scum on the level of Apple and whatnot, but yeah, they have a massive library of games that they've published over the years, and £20 a year, you can just play them, at least a good chunk of them. Like, you can't play the brand new ones, but like the older ones, the ones that, you know, people actually care about, you could just play them as much as you like. That's pretty good. And if Valve can get the other publishers on board and offer us like a Steam-wide, okay, you pay us £30 a year, £40 a year, £50 a year, and you get access to 900 or 1,000 or 2,000 games of your choice. It's like, all right, okay, yeah, no, that... Take my money.
it's basically like a PS Home thing for EA. And like, my thought process went into two directions here. Number one is I can see how models like this would be really useful for like indie scenes. If a bunch of indie developers kind of conglomerated into a publisher, they could maybe get a similar deal with Valve, and that would allow more visibility for their games because a lot of them are fairly niche. But now the other side of that coin is like, okay, well, we're just done with software ownership. It's completely tied to the subscription service. EA can take your games away as much as they want. You can't do anything about it because you paid $20 a year and you agreed to the
terms
of services.
I gotta say, with that, I kind of feel I know what I'm getting. You know,
a little bit, but like this is like the last step. Now software ownership is dead. It doesn't exist anymore. It's just gonna be this.
To be fair, you're already just buying the license to play those games on Steam. Yeah. So,
I mean, it's genuinely no different. I think my initial pitch to Valve, call me, is, you know, give me like 10 games a month at a basic tier, and give me like a $20 tier that has basically anybody that wants to opt in on that. Developers are like, fuck yeah, because you know what?
Guaranteed income.
Yeah. You're going to get a small cut of versus like, I would never. And then people can try games. You know, it's also going to stop, dramatically cut down abuse on the refund system.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It would also really help combat a lot of these Steam key resellers as well, because...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
No,
they
there's no more keys
put
to
a
sell.
Significant dent on them.
Yeah, it's not good news or bad news. It's just news.
The real question is, Pedro, have you already got that EA in your life for all those Need for Speed titles?
No.
Not yet.
Mostly because I've been looking at the Proton DBs and there's still some issues that need to be worked out. Once that jumps up to like gold or platinum, it's like, all right, okay,
I'm genuinely I want to play Titan Floppy.
One thing I'm curious about, though, are most of the games that are going to be on the list, they're going to have like a bunch of old games, but like, are there going to be a lot of microtransaction games? Is that going to be like, oh, we're going to get NBA 2K whatever in everyone's hands?
They can have all. I've never participated in that. Whatever that is supposed to trigger my fucking brain beats, I don't have that because I've never paid for a microtransaction.
Yeah, because you're not a 7-year-old with a credit card.
That sounds like a parenting issue. Yeah,
it's like, Mom, will you punch in your credit card number to my account? It's like, what are you gonna do with it? Don't worry about
it. No. They're giving kids credit cards now. It's
Let's talk about networks and sockets.
Yes. Yeah, Steam sockets. It's a thing that Valve provides. It's really useful because even if you don't want to get on Steam's VPN thing, they say, here's all the stuff for Steam networking. It's a cross-platform library. It doesn't have to use Steam. It integrates with Steam if you want it. But it just handles network connections, pairing, etc., etc. They've added support now in the latest release for peer-to-peer connections. They do some NAT punching. Mm. Yeah. And also because AutoConf doesn't exist under Windows, they're like, yeah, here's a configuration script for you guys, because apparently you can't figure it out.
Mm. Yeah. But, you know, it's basically Valve's way of going, all right, we know that not everyone wants to be on Steam, so we're going to make it easy for every one of those people to use our technology. And maybe, just maybe, in the future, they decide, you know what? They did this thing for us, so we will go check this Steam thing out. Like, anyone doesn't know what it is at this point.
I mean, what, developer goodwill? What do you think this is? Some sort of utopia? Are we living in Star Trek now?
It's Steam's best interest, man. Come over to,
Yeah, it's like, look at all these things we do. Test them. Use them. It's free of charge.
But I had a 30% cut. I'm not getting anything in return on top of what you're giving me.
On top of everything you're giving, including the platform, the software development tools, the VPN.
We were joking about that. At least I was in Discord, because we were talking about CDN pricing and stuff like that. And It's like, you know what? just disguise it as a game. Put a little gaming element and put it on Steam for free.
Oh, I saw the start of that particular discussion, and I'm usually the one who gets accused of arguing on the internet, but damn, Strider and Scott went at it.
Oh shit! On Python performance. Oh, yes. Boy. Oh, that was a scroll through. So
it was fun.
Pedro, I got a question for you.
Oh, no.
As Linux Gamecast's preeminent esports mathlete.
Mathlete.
Mathlete. I don't know.
I was promised there would be no maths.
What do you think about this latest Dota nonsense that's happening with the Invitational?
Well, it's not happening. That seems to be the issue here. Valve's the article is titled "Valve's Silence Over the DPC is Deafening." It's like, what's a DPC?
Oh, thank you. I was like, am I the only one who? What the hell is a DCP?
I thought it had something to do with North Korea at first. I was very confused.
It's the Dota 2 Pro Circuit, and it is, it's basically the culmination of that is supposed to be the big sports event that had like a 34 million prize pool already. And at first they delayed it when, the whole COVID thing
Doesn't
happened.
Doesn't this dude right here look hella nonplussed?
Yes.
He's like,
I think he's trying to put the poker face on.
That is what you see in the Pictionary when you look up GG.
But yeah, it's obviously when this whole situation started, Valve delayed it, and then, it hasn't gone away, so they haven't been saying anything. They haven't officially canceled it yet, but they haven't really said anything on when it's actually going to be happening.
Esports to make it workable, to make it fair. Because they're even having problems. They have problems with cheating when everyone's in the same spot.
Yeah.
This is
and
true.
It's much, much harder to actually have a controlled environment if everyone's doing it from home.
I think the proper response from Valve to this is like, the hell are we supposed to do right now? Fuck off.
Yeah, basically what I think that they should be saying,
really,
but it's Valve, so they're not going to be saying
top
anything.
10 esports games. Number one. With, in terms of prize pool, 226 mil for Dota. Second place, CSGO with 100 mil. Fortnite and third with only 94.
Blizzard was down there too. Like that was what kind of shocked me.
But Blizzard's kind of fucked off with their esport thing with the Heroes of the Storm team. They're like, you know what? We're out of this.
That's true. So a bunch of the other tournament organizers, including Epic Games Event, which has nothing to do with Epic Games. I checked that out. They're a European esports event organizer. And a couple guys like Team Liquid and Evil Geniuses, they're trying to put together their own Dota 2 league. Just to keep things alive and self-maintain a little bit, but maybe buy themselves some time. I don't know how long they can maintain that for, because they're kind of like eating their own limbs at this point. I guess really the crux of this op-ed is Valve's esports arm is slacking off, and do we care?
Not us personally, no. But there are people that do. I've tried every MOBA I've gotten into. Not from lack of trying. I've tried them all.
And it's not just Valve. The article specifically also mentions, it's like, all of the esports thing, they seem to be all getting delayed or canceled. It's like, oh shit. Have you looked outside?
Nope.
Yeah, maybe the worldwide pandemic had something to do with it.
Listen, man, I'm still angry. But I'm not angry about this rounding error.
That's 0.03 is how much Linux increased this particular month in the Steam hardware survey. And while I was looking at that, I also looked, it's like, Mac got 0.14%. It's like, I'm sorry. What? There's 0.14% new Hackintoshes roaming around? Okay.
Yeah, the 1060 is still on the way down in terms of like usage, just looking at the Linux stats. The 480 is getting a lot more use, it looks like, and people are buying 5700 XTs. I guess people, now that they work under Linux, people are buying them.
Yes.
that's really the only like noticeable hardware shift we've seen in the survey. It's something. I haven't gotten the new Steam survey yet. So
one of the things I'm looking at, man, is next time somebody tells you they don't have a mic, call them a liar. 99.99% detected with a microphone.
So every single laptop comes with a microphone right next to the webcam. It's that teeny tiny little hole that's not the LED.
There was
100% of webcams also come with microphones too. So
there was an uptick in VR with, you know, again, a lot of people are at home. They've like 1.2%. That's not insignificant. So
it's not.
Yeah.
Good.
It's the Rift S apparently that's getting a little more.
It's the cheap one. Yes.
The cheap one.
Tinker Launch. It's got an update. We've definitely talked about it. Pedro, to fill people back in, that just radically simplifies all of your settings for you, like what?
All the games. Yeah, all the games that aren't in the whitelist. Some of them require those specific little adjustments, and you can set those adjustments in a text file, and then you just load STL before the game in Steam, and it applies those little tweaks on a per game basis, which now, is a one-time setup, and then boom, done.
There's a new version out, and there's a huge update, because you know it's huge, because look, it's in bold, therefore it is huge. They have added the initial automatic import and conversion of Lutris installers.
Yeah, Strider was talking about this in Discord. Apparently there's some back-channel communication going on. STL is going to be shipping with Lutris, but like, I mean, it makes sense. It's just a Zenity little front end for all the game tweaks.
And a couple of code cleanups, optional Media Foundation support. That's good to see that in their restructured tweak files. So moderately more efficient tweaking and under tweaks, all good. That's good. I'm glad little tools like that, because I have a slightly better chance of messing with something like that than heading over and fishing through ProtonDB.
Oh yeah, and like trying to find the magic combination of environment variables and whatnot. This is a handy little. It's basically Wine Tricks, but for the rest of Steam.
Wine Tricks and man, what was it? Oh, we'll talk about it in the Humble Bundle. Do you keep a copy of like a Proton GE laying around?
I do.
Yeah. Yes.
I had to throw that at something earlier this week, but I'll talk about that in the news segment.
Ew.
Spoilers. New games.
Shing.
Yeah, this one, I saw it show up on the new releases list. I was like, oh, okay, that doesn't look terrible at all. So I decided to email the developers, and, well, wouldn't you know it, they sent us some keys. But it is, the description is interesting. Experience the most exciting and immersive beat-em-up combat system ever. What combat system, you might be asking? Well, it's kind of like a twin stick situation. Yeah. Basically a lot of this.
Yeah, they sent us keys, so big ups on the publisher for that. But yeah, I spent the game with like my hand on the controller like this, and then the other hand on the analog stick just going.
I thought that was just me, but apparently not.
No, it's the Mario Party strat. Like this is like old skills that I have developed so that I don't get eliminated from Mario Party games.
Flailing gets shit done.
Oh, yep. Man. So stay tuned for the ChairQAsition. We'll be giving full in-depth thoughts on it. It needs online multiplayer. Spoiler alert.
Oh man. Cowboys and Penguins.
Cowboys and Penguins. Yeah, so we were promised this a while ago, Desperados 3 for Linux. They said it's coming eventually. And the new DLC adds it. So we threw chairs at the first Desperados. It was basically like a real-time satellite-y rain game where you're a cowboy. You shoot people. You want to be a cowboy, baby. And just blast Kid Rock across the Wild West. Yeah. But yeah, they made it available with the new DLC.
Mac and cheese?
Mac and cheese. Mm-mm. So that's it. I mean, if you really like the first Desperados, then the second one maybe.
You better really like Desperados, because this is $49.99. What's the American cash is?
there's a bit of a cult following around, not just Desperados, but the Commando series, the first two that were like full-on real-time strategy games. And then Desperados is basically Commandos. The first one even used the same engine, like, exactly. They just put new skins on all the characters, but yeah, it's Commandos with cowboys.
It's also 21 gigs, so that's a chunky isometric.
Yeah. Real-time strategy. I mean, it's still probably smaller than Civ 6, so...
Well, like, what, Civ 6 is like 50, want to say?
Yeah.
Laughs in Batman. Laughs in Shadow of Wardour. Wardour, more like it.
Or Elite Dangerous. Yeah.
But hey, good news. That's not the only game that ends with number 3 this week.
It is. Half-Life 3 confirmed. It's Crusader Kings 3. So, once again, you can figure out how to commit incest, assassinate a pope, and burn down a peasant village and blame it on Portugal. And then you can sit down and have a nice relaxing game of Crusader Kings 3. You all know what it is.
I've been doing it wrong the whole time, Ben. I was trying to incest a pope.
Indeed. I mean, you can. It just takes a little bit of work. You need to get a brother or sister as the pope. It's out. You know the memes. You know what this game is about. Political scheming, machination, etc., etc. It's a big old spreadsheet simulator. It's the granddaddy of spreadsheet simulators, and they have the third version of it out.
You know it's a good game when, like, the trailer shows fuck all gameplay.
Right, because you know what it's about.
It's this.
Yeah. It's less of an RTS game and more of a meme generator in RTS form.
I'm going to say
it's not real time. It's not. It's turn based.
It's turn based. Right.
This is a medieval equivalent to like Motorsports Manager.
This is like the text RP equivalent of Besiege.
Yeah, but yeah, no, I did some reading actually on the new things that they introduced with Crusader Kings 3, and apparently one of the things that you can do is when you start a campaign, even in the old Crusader Kings, you used to be able to like select, okay, this particular religion likes this and hates that, likes this and hates, like, people distribution is balanced throughout the world or is more focused on where it would be, you know, IRL. But here, they've completely gone off the deep end, and they let you change everything. It's like, do you
play
Popes
and Aliens?
You can completely randomize the distributions of religions all over the world. If you want to completely lose that basis in reality, you can, and you can set religions to like all manner of sexual behaviors or really hate them. They've basically given people all of the options to generate all the memes, and I kind of want to see that.
Yep.
It's going to cost you $49 because this week all games ending with 3 are $49.99.
It's a Paradox game. They've been really good to Linux. They've been sure to release most of the stuff that they put out on Linux.
Like Desperados 3. This is like one of the, if it's your jam, you don't care. It'd be $60. But like.
Exactly. You know, you could probably get $50 worth of enjoyment out of this game. Enjoyment. With the technology.
Thanks, Snubbin.
That we have to die.
Coming up next, we talk about the technology that we have tomorrow, or in the far future when Jensen's leather jacket produces them from the ether.
And, well, as we contemplate whether or not 2020 in the future will be regarded as a good year.
I was kind of looking at the picture. I'm like, where is downside to this?
Yeah. There might not be, you know, as big a downside as what's coming in the future, but until the future gets here, you can make financial... very poor financial decision of supporting us if you'd like to, please.
I don't know if the person doing the stripping is the stripper, is the person who's watching the strippy. You can decide.
I'm just saying we need some extra capital because I can't buy that abandoned cathedral in Portugal, so I'm gonna have to bribe government officials.
Can we get the prison?
The prism?
The prison. You know that one that was on sale?
Oh, that's only like $300,000.
Yeah, man, is that still available? Can we do that?
I'm scared. I've intentionally not went to that listing.
Well, if you want to give us a bunch of money to help us buy an old prison in what, North Carolina, you
dude,
can head
totally
over to
doesn't look like a prison from the outside, dude.
No. Yeah.
It just looks like a house.
The listing just shows the house part, and then like picture 32 is just like, oh, and there's a hatch, and that leads to the prison. If you want to help us buy a prison, head on over to linuxgamecast.com, put your mouse over the support button. We got lots of ways for you to support us. We got
click on
pay,
shit, buy stuff, become a patron. Oh yeah, we got merch too. Put us on your
baby. store.linuxgamecast.com.
Buy some stickers. We got stickers that look like that. See, look, product demo.
If you don't want to wear a shirt, put some stickers over your bits and then people won't be offended.
Put some stickers over your shirt, confuse people.
Indeed. Patreon is the best way to support us. Patreon.com/LinuxGameCast. If you're Patreon, you get to show up an hour early on Saturdays. We get pre super shows and you get to hear us slap fight each other.
You know, even better, you don't, but you know you could.
You could, yeah. You,
yeah.
Yes.
Or you could even come in and join the slap fight. That capability is still present.
Yeah.
No one takes it up on it. A little bit more money a week and you get access to the show notes. You can watch us congeal the show together. You can offer suggestions, offer corrections, shout things at us. We basically give you right access to the show notes.
Shout stuff at us, pop over in that Discord, fam.
That's true. You get access for being a Patreon or a Twitch sub now, yeah?
Twitch sub, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I guess that's it. We don't have anyone to thank this week.
Don't think we got anyone.
Well, we do.
What?
We need to thank Nubbin for a 4-month resub on Twitch. Thank you very much.
See, this week I was just going to look at you guys. It's been a minute since we've creeped on their wish list.
Going to be my new TV. I'm going to buy that next week.
That's
so going to
be your TV.
Don't worry
32?
About that.
All right. And how long until that ends up on your desk?
About 20 minutes.
Yep. It won't because it doesn't fit.
XLR cables. You don't have anything.
Power supply,
fine, man. What you got?
Laptop room.
Mine's more boring. I get storage gems, chairs, camera, office stuff. Stuff we need.
Tablet.
In the studio. Let's see. Jordan wants barracudas or iron wolves. And of course, the genuine leather dog gimp mask, bound slave cap, adult sex toys, pointed ear with mouth, plug, eye, leather hood, sexy helmet, unisex SM sex toy.
Or a USB-C dock or another
or an NVMe drive.
I got some D&D shit on there too. If you wanna, like I give you options. There's a wide
Here's
range of
thing.
Pricing.
The reason we didn't set these up for years and years and like 5 years because it's a horrible idea. Because it's like the pay for play type thing. You get to send a message. You can get creative. And forces my Yahoo ass included to read it out. And if you do anything for the studio, you end up back here where you can't even read your name. So. How much would you pay for that? That's what I'm saying.
If you get in now, you could probably get your name in there just in below.
Oh, go ahead, Pedro. Just below who?
I think Aldius?
No, it's Noctuals.
Noctuals.
Free advertising kits.
That's another thing you can get for being a patron. We'll give you a plug at the end of the show.
Yeah, you can do that, man. Look at it this way: you can inflict eye strain on other viewers.
That's my name.
we still have the option if you want to actually be on the show, you can still buy your way out of the
you
show.
Can. Let's take this. We've had some people not take us up on that. They were the position. But that's another thing, man. That's like Netflix. That's why I don't watch shit on Netflix. I know I can if I wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's one of the things. As an executive producer, you'll get live video when we go live for the pre super shows and when we do the after shows, games, and stuff like that. If you want to exercise that option, which most of our executive producers are really nice about it, but you can cut in line. That's the thing.
Indeed. Yep.
It's kind of brilliant. But we want to talk about us spending money on shit we don't need, and NVIDIA's like, man, do I got something for you, man.
Do I have something you really don't need?
Dude, RTX 30 series, Pedro and myself, we covered the live stream with Jensen and his sexy leather jacket. We tried our best to talk over all the important bits, but what was announced? A couple of things. The big one, the one that made sense to a lot of people. Where's the auto scroll? You do that while I'm talking, baby. What's the 3070 coming in at $500? Because we've even seen the rumors floating around. That's going to make AMD's life hella difficult. It is. Mm-hmm. Only having 8 gigs for that is going to make it difficult for me to justify buying one, but as we were talking earlier, the 2080 Ti's, you can buy them now on the eBays for like $700-800, which is half.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good time to upgrade if you've been holding out. But yeah, we got rumors of like big Navi coming later or two, and the rumor mill is that we're going to be getting a 16 gig card out of them that's going to be sort of in between the price range or performance range of the 3070 and 3080. Maybe, I don't know. AMD, man, they've overpromised in the past, so I want to see some actual real world performance before. Oh man, look at those. That paint on the
that's it's, coming it's, in crisp at 360. Oh no, 720. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Hang on, can I go to 144 in this?
Yeah.
Do. Hang on, keep going. As you,
you were saying. So right now we have CUDA core counts, we have memory bus width, and we have memory or available memory. But that doesn't mean anything.
Have it go away. You know what?
There's no anisotropic filtering that will help you at 144p.
No. So, but yeah, we got the 3090, which is the big super ultra mega chonky boy. That's the one that is going to hurt some things because if it's going to fit, I mean, it's three slots. 2080, reasonable-ish for NVIDIA pricing, $800. And
it was 700, wasn't it? 699?
799.
No? I think, I don't know.
Scrolling.
Pricing information, man. But that's definitely spurred the rumors that
$699.
AMD is going to have to put their 12 gig variant on the market for less than what the 2070 is going to be coming out, or very close to it, which is a good deal for consumers. But it's bad for AMD because, you know, there goes the margins on that.
Yeah, and AMD really needs a win, especially in the GPU market. And I hope that they can put something out that undercuts NVIDIA and they can still make a profit out of it. Because that 3070 was basically laser targeted at, you know, 1080 users. And I was looking at it, it's like, oh yeah, no, that's very good. Okay, what's the price? $500. Nope.
$500.
Those 99 and maybe.
This because is where you I want get something me, though, with that raw compute with the CUDA. And according to NVIDIA, no, don't buy pre-order or anything. I don't even think you can pre-order from NVIDIA for this. Faster than a 2080 Ti.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
As far as we know,
according to the like the ray tracing performance, or I don't know,
dude. I mean, come on, TensorFlops.
Yeah, and you gotta get those TensorFlops.
It is the worst too because under DixVix, it doesn't matter. We don't get any RTX on. So,
I will. Absolutely, 100% say, ladies and gentlemen, if they hit me with $500 with a 12 gig, preferably 16, but a 12 gig card at $500, I wouldn't blink. I'd buy one for this box right here, strictly for rendering. But at 8 gigs,
do you have any news on like the encoder being shipped with it?
They didn't mention anything about the encode, and if they had done something remotely impressive, as much random shit as they were hauling out with like, look, NVIDIA Studio, dip, dip, dip. Then they had the guy talking across the front finger microphone. I'm like, really?
Mm-hmm. yeah, they call it in the promotional material next generation hardware encoding. But
if it was any improvement in the encode over Turing, they would have said something, which they didn't. Mm-hmm. That's all I'm going to say about that. So, yeah, nothing, just a buttload more CUDA cores, more compute, and I'm down with that.
More RAM, wider RAM bus.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's the thing. All right, so let's talk about OBS Studio, everyone's favorite studio named OBS. Release Candidate 1 is out. I've installed this. Well, installed it. I've compiled it, built it, then installed it. The new hotness in this is RN Noise. So that's the thing. It's like RTX voice without the NVIDIA card. It does work. It's a bit of a sledgehammer. They've added sRGB color support for more accurate color representation just in time for YouTube to like mess that up. So use 709 right now. Go ahead and switch that back. They're about to make that change internally. And what else? Oh, this is why I wanted pager to play with it, USB encoder, a bunch of other stuff, NV encode, more friendly warning, da da da, a couple of Linux fixes, but OBS browser, I know at least if you build off master, is included now. So I don't know if the release candidate pager's like, hey, I don't want to install an unstable version.
No, I really don't want to put the unstable PPA or...
So help me out, Pedro. What do you have against building the standalone version, which I've did an easy like copy pasta job on a Debian system of how to do that?
Just I was building OBS from source
for it or something.
What?
Long before that tutorial up there.
back in my day, I tied an onion on my belt because it was the style. No, I was gonna say you put out a bash script for doing for setting up NV encode on OBS.
You don't need that anymore.
Don't need it anymore.
No.
Old news.
If it sees NV encode on your system, it will expose it.
Yes.
It checks off of one thing. But, you might have a browser source in there. We're not going to be using the unmaintained Linux browser.
Which I'm still using. Of course, and has been working relatively well for the past few weeks. And at this point, I can play Fallout 3, the game can crash, and OBS stays running, which is a big plus. It's something that didn't happen for the longest time on Linux, so I'm very reluctant to update.
My OBS been crashing all the time, baby. I mean, left and right. It just happens to do it when I'm not streaming. It crashes when I'm not even running in it. It's crashing. That's what's going on.
Your computer's not even on and OBS is crashing.
Dude.
If I'm running a game that's prone to crashing, I don't want OBS to crash along with it.
Yeah, you do. It'd be entertaining as hell. Why are you denying people entertainment? The hell's wrong with you?
I think the game crashing is entertainment enough.
It's there. Go try it. I'll put a link in the show notes if you there's a PPA, the official PPA. Install it through that if that is an option. If not, build it. Because if you show up in the OBS Discord with your flat packs or your snaps, you'll be politely told to die in a fire. Those are completely unsupported. So it's on you. Yeah. So get the official PPA. There's a development channel. If not, just build it yourself. It takes 10 seconds. They're on the wiki. They have Fedora. They have Debian. They have Suzy. Ooh, they have Arch.
I can compile stuff with J24. I'm excited.
Oh, yeah. There you go. OBS is brilliant at J24. It literally takes 15 seconds.
Excellent.
You're just like, boop, you're like, linking, done. All right.
I got to compile some kernels on here, too, just for fun.
12 minutes if you're building everything.
Yeah.
All right.
All right. Humble Bundle. There's a new one out. This one is the 1C Publisher Bundle.
Okay,
so
Jordan, does that look like a
1C? That looks like an
E.
It looks like 11. That looks like 11 CE. Let's be real.
It looks like 11 at, kind of.
But then there's the R for the registered trademark, so it's 11 sir.
You have 9 days, sir. 16 hours, yep. 5 minutes, and 36 seconds to what can they unlock?
Well, if you're just paying the basic bitch, you only get Gift of Parthenax as the Linux native version. If you pay a little bit more for the extra butt, you get Codex of Victory and Realpolitik. And if you pay more than everyone else, you get Deep Sky Derelicts and Felseal, which I actually both games I quite enjoy. I would give that a recommendation.
And Conglomerate 451.
Conglomerate 451, is that one all right?
I don't know. I haven't tried it yet.
They also have Stygian as well at that level, and then just a bunch of DLC for the top tier stuff. So,
six Linux games.
It's not
and
a bad
two
bundle.
Bits of DLC. Yeah, pretty good.
Admittedly, the only thing I saw in there was it wasn't even a Linux title. They had Devil's Hunt. I had heard such horrible things about this game to the point to where I was willing to spend some money to see if it lived up to the hype.
Well, it'll only cost you $1.31, right?
It lived up to the hype. It's terrible.
The guy on the cover looks like Johnny Cage from the 90s Mortal Kombat movie.
Dude,
that's
okay.
Any indicator.
Now, if we're just...
It's not Devil May Cry.
No, it's not. It's like somebody described Devil May Cry and that person was a little schnockered, but
Devil will weep uncontrollably.
To put it to you simply, is simply the combat. Imagine going through Devil May Cry only using your left and right shoulder buttons.
Oh, Dark Souls, got it.
Then you're not allowed to move anywhere because every movement, you can jump, but only where it tells you you can jump or jump over a platform. You got to get to the point, then wait to let it cinematically
jump. On rails.
Dude, bad. Then it goes off rails for a circle it can put you in to where you can press your left and right shoulder buttons and hopefully do something. When it's not stuttering and janking up because it has horrible performance issues under Windows. And you know what? DXVK doesn't help issues.
It sounds amazing. So we're just starting a new stream series next week.
I got 12 minutes into it and I wasn't even angry. I said, well, all right, I've had enough. Fair enough. And uninstalled it. It's not little either. It's like 20 gigs.
So, actually, Jordan, you brought up Stygian. That was the reason that I ended up buying the bundle at the £12 or $12 level.
Yeah, it's the Lovecraft RPG, which
it's an RPG in the vein of Baldur's Gate and Icewind Dale.
Actually, shit. Yeah, I think I'm gonna pay the $15 for that too. I guess if anyone wants a copy of Fel Seal and Deep Sky Derelicts, DM me.
Yeah, no, I got some. So yeah, let us know.
All right. Let's talk about your dong, Pedro.
Hang on, I want to see what happens.
It cuts away before anything happens. But
I pyramid.
This is about Hammerdongers. It's a game that we talked about before, and at the time, Jordan had
the
very
one with the alcoholic knights carrying hammers.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Yes, it is. And Jordan had a very apt description for it, so much so that the developer even left us a comment on YouTube to say, it's like, that's the best description of my game I ever heard of. Thanks. Paraphrasing a little bit there. But yep. Yeah, this is an update, and they say it's like a shadowy figure lurks, an antagonist. And then you see the little gif, and there's a very Shovel Knight looking boss thing.
It looks like something out of like the Game Boy Color Legend of Zelda games, and I'm 100% here for it. I dig this guy's design.
They've also added a score in game because everyone was requesting it. It's like, why wasn't there that there in the first place? Because if you have a competitive game where people are going up against each other, chances are they'd like to know that. Maybe no. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. The what do you call it? They've added the visual cue now because like part of it is you need to destroy the ground underneath people.
Dope.
It
gives, new it gives music,
you,
bruh.
Gives you a heads up. So that's pretty handy as well. Yeah, that's it. Earth shaking visuals is what I put in the notes.
Pretty good update, would you say?
I mean, it's certainly an update. We've seen worse from. Worst game, so yeah.
We've seen complete non-updates too, so yeah, that bar is pretty low.
So, I mean, go try it out for free. Hammer Donger, your 0.5 release. It's small too, 93 megs, so put that in your donger and smoke it.
Yeah, cavecraw.itch.io. The links to all this other stuff is in our show notes.
Yeah.
So you should check those out. Up next, while you were playing Nick's games, we were studying the blade. Or kicking around with our analog sticks. Find out which. Welcome back to the ChairQAsition, where we throw chairs at games and tell you how they work under Linux distributions. What? We got three of them.
Stop motherfucking ChairQAsition.
It's the motherfucking ChairQAsition. This week we're taking a look at Shing from Mass Creation, done on the Unity engine. You can pick it up for about $20. What is it? Experience the most exciting and immersive beat-em-up combat system ever. Become a kick-ass ninja and slice some demons in style. We got to thank Mass Creation for sending us some keys. We're going to start the review now. How did it work under Debian?
I don't know. I'm not ready to start the review yet, so you keep on talking, baby.
All right, sure.
How was your day?
It was all right. I woke
Jeez,
up.
Jeez, man, I'm trying to do a review. Oh, man. What happened, Pedro? There it is. Ta-da!
It was loading.
Ladies and gentlemen, how did it run over here on Debian 10.5? That hotness, man. I'm running that on a 1920X Red Zipper, 32 gigs of RAM. Supporting an NVIDIA 2060 no-cape edition. Little baby one. ran pretty good, man. That initial load, like, is seriously no joke. I was having Deus Ex flashbacks, man. Not quite that long, but it took about a minute and a half. But everything did work out of the box. I didn't have any issues with it, man. It was holding a solid 60 at 2160p and 1080p. I was glad to see that. Again, out of the box, X-Clone Wireless. Picked right up, no issues, button prompts, they were correct. I was the happy. So I started my adventure. Out of the gate, you know, you're going to find yourself thinking, like, immediately through the, just right at the beginning, like the little, hey, learn how to play the game. This is different. Why? Because it's a brawler. It's not a button masher. It's more like a D-swinger, man. You got to swing that analog stick around and around and around because that's the mechanic, man. Gone are the days of button mashing. We have to enter this brave new world of flailing about with the analog stick in hopes of doing something, basically. Now, that's kind of where the game lost me, right out of the gate. And it lost me hard, man, because for a brawler, I need this reliable base, you know, just a little bit of a strat to maybe, like, clear my surroundings and kind of get that conga line of smackdown set up. Shing? Couldn't deliver it for me. I couldn't figure out how to do it. Like, not even a little bit, man. Like, jumping around and slinging the stick proved basically just as effective as attempting something resembling a strategy, which I tried. It's like, oh, if I do that with a combo of Haruken, no, just juggle the stick, man. Works just as good. And the thing is, here's the real kicker. I was never punished for doing this. Not even once. Just happily got through all the levels that I was going through in my playthrough. Nope, that works just as well as pretending you're actually doing something. Flailing about wildly. Get shit done, kids. Well, all right. Yeah, so here's my takeaway. You smash effectively the same four batteries. Batteries, yes, you smash batteries. Baddies.
Batteries.
Like in the first hour of gameplay, very limited baddie selection. You progress. You get some edgy preteen dialogue, then you repeat that. More of the same. You know what? There might be something to the local-only multiplayer, but it's not there in single player. And you know what? Steam Remote Play exists in a worst-case scenario. It's very non-optimal. But I'll give you this. I'm going to give you this, Shing. You get a nice little anime opening at the beginning movie that I didn't expect. I was like, okay, there's this. All right. It kind of maybe set my expectations up a little higher than they should have been. But yeah, clocking in at $19.99, it's not outrageous. If this had like legitimate full online multiplayer support, maybe. But yeah, there's no strategy. You might say, hey, I don't want strategy in my beat 'em up. I kind of want a little bit. And this, if you can just cheese the entire way through it, you can swap between the characters. I didn't notice much of a difference between them. And thanks for sending us keys. I do apologize. It's just not my jam, but maybe that's why there are three of us. Jordan has a different opinion.
Yeah, on Fedora 32 64-bit. Now I gotta remember not to say the old processor. It's the Ryzen 3900X with the GTX 1080 Ti. Oh, that's always fun mixing that up. Yeah, it launches out of the box. I turned off VSync, and at UHD, I'm getting like plus 100 frames a second, so performs decently well. I really like the part in Metal Gear Solid 2 and in Metal Gear Solid 1 VR missions when you get the katana, and apparently so do the devs of this game because they base their entire control scheme around it. It definitely looks like a Unity 3D game, especially on the wide exterior shots. I'm like, yeah, that's some Unity. And I'm pretty sure the voice acting is supposed to be bad, like Girl Chen in Paradise, I think. So I burned my right thumb cooking before I started playing the game, so it's not really the game's fault, just crappy timing. But the big thing here is the fighting combo mechanic. You wiggle the right analog stick and your sword, naginata, axe, or tantos, or whatever you have, swing about, and in theory you could use this freeform style to do some really sweet kung fu ass kicking, but in reality you just kind of end up flailing as you're not really able to be consistent. There's the dodge mechanic,
Smash
and that
Bros.
Has a... Yeah, there's a dodge mechanic, has a real nasty cooldown, not a fan, especially if you dodge at the wrong time, and failing that, the game really wants you to, like, perfect parry stuff, and gives you, like, a lot of lead up. Enemies' eyes flash, and they do a little animation before they attack, so you can get the perfect parry off. But it's not really helpful when multiple enemies do it at the same time, and you're like, I just dodged, well, shit, I guess I'm dead now. So I tried a bit of the online multiplayer with Mr. Fox Dog Steam Remote Play. It was all right. It has the default effect of like elevating a mediocre experience because you have a friend there and you can make jokes.
How did Steam Remote Play, considering you're in Canada and he's in Australia? That's hard mode.
It was all right. The other problem he had was he had to use a keyboard and mouse, which is a problem I've run into. Multiple controllers are a little dicey on my box. I need to look into that at some point. But yeah, like it worked well enough. Like Foxy wasn't really complaining about any lag. Well, I mean, there's the obvious lag there, but that's implicit with the remote streaming solution. Also, the third boss, real nasty because like it's a giant slog of enemies, and then by the end, they give you these guys to like heal you, but by the time you kill them all, the boss shows up and despawns all the health items, so you're just like, guess what, fuck you asshole. I don't know, the game's just okay. I think it's one of those things that ends up being a lot better on paper, but like, where's my controller? Yeah, when you're doing like woo, there's not really a lot you can reliably do. I'm gonna give it two cheers.
Yeah, and over here on the Ryzen 7 3700X and the GTX 1080, yeah, it did the launching. On a couple of occasions, the loading screens froze, and I thought the game itself had frozen. But no, it just takes a while.
It definitely has some loading screens, don't it?
It does! And yeah, it did, at least, you know, when the action was actually going, it did hold 144 FPS at 2560 by 1440, so... good. The DualShock 4 sort of worked out of the box, but the buttons were slightly misaligned, as in they told you to hit the cross to confirm, but no, it was actually a circle. So everything was like one button over in a circle, so it's like, okay, alright. So I just enabled Steam input and I worked around that. The voice acting, yeah, it was just on the right side of campy, and it fits. It absolutely fits. And the background music was very generic, like supposedly, you know, East Asia, Southeast Asia twanging, but I didn't enjoy it. It got muted fairly quickly. As for the fun, I actually had quite a lot of fun with this game. It's pretty damn hard in Forever Alone mode. Every level after the first boss is a bit of a chore, and if you're not careful, you get stuck in a fuck you cascade with enemies basically timing their attacks perfectly to ensure you can never actually get up. So yeah, the control scheme, yeah, like everyone's already mentioned, you use the right analog stick to do the swinging, and the swinging acts according to how you push the analog stick. If you do like the twirls, it does the little sword swinging in a circle. If you just hit a direction, it slices in that direction. So I ended up just, yeah, like Jordan said, holding the controller on my left hand, and then with my right hand going... that was it. That was literally all I did, doing the shimmy sham with the right analog stick. Which, you know, it meant the big fuck you whenever you're expected to start dropping bombs, which are bound to the, you know, right bumper, which means I had to stop attacking enemies to hit the right bumper and then go back to the shimmy sham. That said, though, it's still pretty fun. It's not perfect, and there are a couple of instances that could have been so much better, and the characters could have felt a heck of a lot different from one another, because as Jordan mentioned, they are basically the same thing. But yeah, I had fun, so three cheers.
All right, well, there you go. It's okay. Maybe wait for it to go up. Ah, yes!
All
professional
of them.
Podcasting Linux, episode 420. That's what's happening. Yeah, so there you go. Coming up next.
Jordan's decided there's no final thoughts this evening.
I don't know. Do you want to do some final thoughts? Let's do some final thoughts.
All right. Give them to me.
I mean, honestly, I think the combat is a little lacking. Some of the targeting's off. The combos aren't super reliable, which, like you said, Ben, is kind of crucial to beat them up. The power-ups, I don't know what the pink ones do. I get that the
pink
the yellow
is
one.
You get a free hit without taking damage.
Is that it? Okay. Yeah. That's all. That's a little dumb.
Now, it's clearly very well done. Now, it is. You can tell a lot of work went into this. This is not any way we're trying to accuse this of being like a lazy.
Oh, no. There's definitely work in here. I just think the core mechanic.
Here's my theory on that core mechanic.
Sure.
Would you bet money against this starting life as a mobile game?
I could see this being like very good as a mobile game.
I'm just thinking with the touch mechanic of like swiping for your attack would make more sense.
But again, like this has been a thing for like Metal Gear Solid Revengeance does this too, right?
Is
like,
that a 2D game?
No, it's not. And I think that's kind of the problem is that sort of swinging control mechanism works a little bit better in 3D than it does in 2D, at least I think, or at least from like a top down perspective.
Yeah.
Something where you're not facing from the side, not as a side scroller.
Hmm. Yeah, I did find it very difficult to pull off combos, and you can't be terribly precise with an analog stick. It's just not designed for that. It's for the sweeping motions, you know?
Yeah, it's meant for movement, for the kind of analog movement.
I like that they tried something. I mean, I'm a fan of trying something new for a mechanic. I just don't felt that it
and they try to like make it a thing because they're like, use arcing motions, use sweeping motions, like take advantage of it. It's crucial to beat the game, and it's not. But you know, good on you for like trying to convey that.
Yeah. It was a different approach to it, but yeah, it could have worked just as well if they hadn't tried to reinvent the whole combat system, and they'd just gone with the simple one button for one attack, another button for another attack.
I give them credit for trying, though.
There's so many buttons then used on the controller. Just have more attacks bound to those.
here's another thing. Like, there's like an attack stamina mechanic where like once you stop, there's like a couple seconds before you can start like swinging into a combo again. That really screws you over.
Mm.
It really does.
And it's not terribly quick to change directions facing.
No, that's the other thing too.
Like when you're trying to block behind you, good fucking luck sometimes.
Yeah. If you want to do fighting game style combos, then like, I don't know, in an action beat 'em up game, it doesn't kind of work the same.
Again, I think a lot of this goes away if you have four people playing.
There's a lot better like enemy management when you have that second person there. I don't know about third or fourth. We didn't try. But yeah, maybe. But again, this is where like proper online multiplayer would really help.
Yeah.
But
there is that.
What can you do? All right, coming up next, we got some hate mail. We're going to talk about gift cards again because Valve is cracking down on cards.
Cards.
Well, this wasn't a terribly long show, was it?
Yeah, it was.
Not like last week.
We dragged it, man.
It was like an hour and a half last week. We're only like an hour and five right now.
This episode's got some like rug burn on it, man. We dragged it quite a bit.
See how short Jordan's gotten through the episode?
I know. and I'm shrinking.
Progressively shorter.
That's how stretched out. I'm just getting wider and shorter.
If you'd like to let us know just how shorter you've gotten over the course of listening to us, you can go to linksgamecast.com, you hit the contact button, and fill out the form. LGC Weekly is usually the default show, so feel free to send us some hate mail, and it'll be featured right here, right now. Unless you're one of our Patreons, you can leave us a comment on Patreon.
So
of course, obviously,
you went from, like,
we'll read those.
That tall to... Wait, you need arms. Yeah. There we go. Don't ask me about your extended neck arm things. I don't know.
Hey man, don't judge my extended neck arm
things. Yes,
I'm very sensitive about it.
Yeah, somebody make a gif of that. That'll be grueling. We'll make that the new page roller.
Indeed. All right.
Works for me.
We got some hate mail from
one
Ertain.
One.
Yeah, sent this on YouTube, yeah?
Yeah.
They say, I work at a CVS, and I cannot tell you the number of times...
No, we need to roll this back before we get into it.
Oh, yeah, that's true. We were talking about Steam cracking down on gift cards a couple weeks ago.
They made a policy where you couldn't purchase it outside of your native currency, right?
Yes. So like if you're in Canada or whatever, you have to pay for Canadian gift cards and whatnot, mm-hmm. blah, blah, blah. So yeah, he says he works at a CVS. Cannot tell you the number of times he's seen people get scammed for the Steam gift cards. While we try our best to ensure the customer isn't getting scammed, I saw people buying hundreds of dollars of Steam gift cards. Once or twice, I saw old ladies buying these things and hope they were for grandkids or a relative. Every time I would ask, are these the gift? And they would say yes. That's all I could do to deter them if they were getting scammed in the first place. There are even prompts on the pin pad to make sure these people aren't being scammed, but I don't know whether that works.
It
I mean,
doesn't.
No, people it does
straight up don't read what's on screen. As someone who currently works in support, they
okay.
really
so,
fucking don't.
So here's an anecdote from my time working at a gas station that proves people don't read. One time we ran out of regular gas. You know how you can get like the regular, the higher octane fuels, right? So we ran out of regular gas and they told me, hey, put up signs that say, hey, we're just going to sell premium gas for the cost of regular just so that like you can still get your car filled. And I put up the signs and literally everyone for like the next hour came in and said, hey, are you guys out of gas? I'm like, no, read the sign. Premium's the same cost as regular gas. No one fucking reads the sign. No one does.
I have a question though.
Yeah.
Because I know it is customary here if they're out of petrol, they just put a bag over the pump that's out of gas. Or did you have like all three from one?
Yeah, they all went from like one supply.
Ah, so was you could have there needs to be a way to program it to like insert more tokens.
Maybe. I mean, if you get the Sega card, you can like swipe it and you can get a free play every 10 tokens.
Well, I think of like scamming, I definitely think of like PayPal cards and stuff like that, or what are the money dot cards things?
Money dot?
Green dot.
Green dot, PaySafe, there's a bunch of virtual currency cards out there. And yes, chances are, if you look hard enough, you'll find several instances of every single one of those having been used for nefarious purposes.
It's just, when I think about, like,
point,
there's a, like, cabal of, like, oh, no, we're scamming people, we're getting free Steam games, yeah.
That's the thing. It's a money laundering. It's a way to launder money, by attempting to scam people, and it's sad, but it's the reality of things.
Go. This is. I'm like, okay, hello, I'm whoever. I've just got this great inheritance, but in order for me to transfer it to you, you must first provide me with a $30 Steam gift card.
I mean, it can be money laundering in the sense of just like, hey, here's a bunch of stuff that can be converted into another currency that can be converted into like real money, so that this money
so people can't track that money anymore.
Yeah. There's other gift card scams. The article that Valve put up actually lists I forget what agency, but it's one of the Alphabet agencies explaining like what all these various scams are. So you can go check that out.
Hmm.
And it doesn't need to be particularly elaborate, because if you get someone with enough charisma to someone's door to sell them on some complete bullshit, they'll buy it, but they straight up can't read a fucking prompt on a screen.
See, I think I'm along with, I turn things into, like, over-elaborate, because...
That's how your brain works.
Too much faith in humanity, man. I'm like, no, you wouldn't.
No. Humanity is stupid. That's the default status for humans.
The default status.
Yeah. State, whatever.
You know what? We're not going to end with a better inspirational message than that, ladies and gentlemen.
Episode 420, the
yellow swag for Jesus.
We already went past 8 years and we never even addressed it.
Gotta cue the music. Thank you for showing up 420 times for your amusement. It's been a terrifying ride. If you want a terrifying ride, my notifications, head over to Twitter and where I'm at, Vin Stone. I'm doing things there. I'm posting shit and sometimes I post and reply and all that fun stuff. Or just at vin@mass.linuxteamcast.com. I still remember we have one and I use it occasionally.
Ha. I'm Jordan Sfung. I am incredibly intoxicated, and if you want to terrify me, you can message me at The Burning Fool on Twitter.
Mr. Finch, thank you for the follow. I, on the other hand, am Pedro Mateusz, and if you'd like me, if you'd like to watch me fry right here on Terra.
Terra?
It's, yes. Terrified, whatever.
I'm terrified right now.
The Twitter handle thing is at an account at 4, F-O-U-R, you gotta spell it out, otherwise you'd get that person that created their account
at the number 4,
and never used it.
Just remember, ladies and gentlemen, when Pedro gives you terror, make him fries.
Make me fries. On a wizard, on a whale. Oh man, we gotta thank all of the people who are giving us money, enabling us to come here week after week.
Turbo Party Patrons.
Support! We gotta thank Arthurin, Empty, the Atomic Ass, Mike G.
Can we go with Terror Fried or Terror Fried?
Terror Aldius. Mac Geek is very spooky. Mr. Fox Terror. The only spooky.
The only drummer clock. Happy the full drummer. What? Dirty Dean, Grayson, we got Wagner, Mini Jack, Vindicell, Greg, KY Linux, Cast,
Mike
Richard,
Kyoa
Angel,
Yodan,
Wintercell, Jupiter Broadcast, I'm only going with Jill and Steve, so I'm taking the chase this week.
Simca,
Jordan,
Christoph 3, Iris 121, Romeo Sidvicious, Captain Zero,
Jill and Steve, Craig,
Pedro could have used PowerShell on Linux this week, but he didn't.
After another.
And
I used it on Windows 10.
But
Windows
you should have used it on Linux.
Don't throw insults.
Library.tv at Nixon's Pyramid.
Good night, ladies and gentlemen.
Bye.
Toodles.
You did this to yourself.
You do it to us.
Mm.
Five dudes.